that this type of local networks that are local first, as many people call them, that actually they are meant to connect you to local servers, but they are also connected to the internet. We should, to make them successful and serve their purposes, I think we should focus first on the community. I mean, it's some sort of a provocative argument that the technology is not enough to bring a box anywhere, but you first have to work with the people that are supposed to use it, manage it. And to do this, I focus on four different things. One is the stories. We need to engage people and to understand the difference of what it's local, what it's global, what means data. The second is interfaces, usability. If we want to empower people that are not technical, we need to give them tools to manage their own networks, like WordPress, help people publish. We need similar tools to help people create networks. Spaces, we need to create spaces that all these things are hosted, real spaces in the city. And also learning. These are the four things that if we are serious about engaging normal people in all these activities, we should work on. And this is a small reminder of Armin Meadows. He was active in many Battle of the Mess, perhaps some of you have met. He has this nice joke that the hackers, he was a sociologist coming from the political science, but interested in the technology. And the hackers were telling him, read the fucking manual. And then he was replying to them, read the fucking Marx. And he was an advocate for that the problems of all these alternative systems that we build are not only technological, but also political, social, economic. Myself, I have not read Marx, as many Marxists, I think. But I work more on the ecological dimension. There is a nice book from Naomi Klein, This Changes Everything. And I think this is something very important to discuss and a very a new way to attract people that are sensitive and they can engage in such activities. And this is an image to show that we somehow have a feeling between these two images. You know, some who have an emotional reaction that organic, small, it's more cool, tomatoes smell better, food is more healthy. But I think not you, but most people don't understand actually that in the internet we are on this side. I mean, all this Facebook, Google are actually very industrialized, unhealthy things. I go fast through this. I try to develop an analogy with Monsanto and Facebook because people have a feeling about Monsanto. And I even try to brand the term algorithmically modified data, like we say genetically modified organisms. And it's actually, if you think of it, it's exactly what it is. And I try to, sensitize people about Facebook. This is a very nice expression of how Facebook thinks about all the scandals. That's life, accept it. This is a... it's very important for all of you that focus a lot to connect people to the internet to realize that Facebook wants the same. And it's not enough just to plug them in. This is the Facebook, I don't know, plane that connects everybody to the internet. And here Zuckerberg shows his new toy to the pop. It's handing over the colonialist, you know, how to call this. So, the innovation of colonialism. And the question is, okay, all this is nice, but what means organic, no? We know what means organic in agriculture, what means for the internet. And I have been working the last 3 years in two European projects, Net Commons, that was most focused on big infrastructures, like what WiFi, Freifunk, and other big community networks are building. And MAZI, meaning together in Greece, goes on the other extreme, focusing on very small boxes, local networks, thinking how they can be used in practice. I have made even a graph trying to somehow explain that the community networks are not all the same. They are depending on many cultural aspects. Don't look at it. I mean, it's the idea is that we have internet access and local services, so you can put the community networks on an axis based on how much they are focused on local and how much on internet. And introvert, I call networks that are more on between those that build the network, some sort of more closed communities, not a lot of access, for example, to engage people that are not part of the network. In the case of FFDN, introvert means more. That actually it's the first time they are here, for example, in the Battle of the Mess, and I'm very happy that they organized this. And yes, so I don't go to... So this is a little bit to give you a snapshot of how personally I present all these things and how I try to explain to people that are not experts these concepts. And I go through the different networks saying, for example, that Freifunk is more about sharing your internet access for free and making internet accessible, while GWIF is more about commoning. It's about sharing the cost of internet access. And all these are culturally determined. You know, Berlin, anarchist scene, and all these things. Catalonia, commons, we are together. So all these are important. Sarantapore is an example of a team coming from the city, building a network in the country, like a gift to the community, and then struggling to engage the people that live there to run their own network. Many interesting issues, problems. And then we go on the other side. Small boxes, Occupy here, PirateBox, the Can You Hear Me project in Berlin, more artistic, provocative, you know, giving this idea of local networking, this old project, you know, I guess, of about actually having digital infrastructures that are public, owned by the people, but also even more artistic things, chairs that show that there is a free internet access point. At that time, there were no smartphones. It's a project from the US, so people had to sit somewhere to check their email. So somebody put a yellow chair to say, here is a free access point, made the whole project out of it. This is from Dania, you know, putting blogs on trees that they can tell their stories, very localized things, creative. And in my narrative, I say that all this, we should be careful that they will not, you know, save the world, feed the world. And I make the analogy between all these local networks with seed bombs, for example. So having this type of small things around the city, it's interesting. It can serve some purposes, like a few tomatoes that you can grow on your balcony. But yes, we should be aware that it's not enough, and we should create also different infrastructures. I try to depicture the whole this with a tree of open source software that has the infrastructure at its roots. And then there are different types of networks that should help to manage, govern all this type of, let's say, digital plants, trees in different locations. And what is critical is that to be democratic, to be inclusive, you need to meet. I mean, you cannot do it online, clicking, I like, I don't like. So we need places, actually, that all this ecosystem of infrastructure, software, tools, etc., is anchored, is planted, and the people that are in this location have the opportunity to talk, discuss, decide how all these are used. So we did try to this in locations that are already friendly to these ideas. For example, this is a cooperative housing project in Switzerland, in Zurich. This is an urban garden in Berlin. Some of you visited last year in the context of the Battle of the Mess. And the image I try to create is that you have all this, as I said, ecosystem planted in these friendly locations, that then they develop these solutions that we... they refine them, they make them easy to access, and then they start growing, and this utopia of you know, a nice world with nice people, all with their own, yeah. So this was the MAZI project. We did these pilots. The outcome was some sort of a WordPress-like framework how to set up for you a pirate box. I mean, a pirate box is by default a file sharing system. What we tried in this is to put a little bit of the UnoHost functionality on the WordPress-like interface and packaging all this together with guidelines on how to make a nice sign explaining how to connect to the network. This is the most difficult challenge, by the way, for local networks. The fact that people have to type a URL is a no-go. It's very problematic, very difficult. I mean, we have struggled a lot for this extra step. Anyway, I will not talk a lot about it. If you want, we can discuss, I can explain. What happens now, this is on GitHub. And if people are interested, I'm very much, because the European project has finished, personally, I don't want to work many of the people that were there. So I'm very interested to fork it or replicate ideas from it. I mean, if you are into this domain, I'm very much interested to collaborate, to do something beyond this. My organization is called NetHood. And actually, our work is trying to connect different areas of research activism in these areas. This is a photo from Berlin. We had a very interesting session first at the Battle of the Mess in a dark room with many lights and screens, etc. And then went to the garden with people that at that time were fighting against Google. I don't know if you know the story of Google in Berlin, that they wanted to make a big campus. And this is actually a very interesting moment where the urban activists realized that the digital comes to their ground. And this is a moment of realization that actually it's not only, you know, the municipality that manages the garden, the state that takes the that defines the housing, but also these digital companies that land in the physical space and affect it, and we have to do something with it. So, I mean, I could summarize my talk just by saying, go out and meet people that do other things in the city and try to collaborate. It's the only way to, you know, to make all this work on the digital, let's say, emancipation relevant at the local scale. We do such a thing, such a project. We started in Zurich. I will go very fast. It's a new space. We call it by its address. It's in a very central street called Langstrasse 200. So we call it L200. It's this one. It is very interesting that it's extremely central, and we have the ambitious, a very central and visible space to run it as a commons. So, and the only way to do it by paying the market price instead of squatting or being subsidized by the city because you are non-profit is to make an extreme, let's say, sharing, structure. So what we do is to try to keep the space neutral. The only rule is that nobody should dominate its identity, left, right, nobody. So the space is a common space that all the members pay part of the rent. And being many, this amount is very low, but also make easier to run the space. Such a space should be open all day. None of us can be there every day. So the more people are in, the more the space is interesting and active and attractive. So everybody gains by making it a popular location. Myself, I bring also this idea of a local network. We have a rack in the basement where I imagine making a web hosting provider for the neighborhood, for small artists to have their websites hosted on this specific place. I have a MAZI local network that we do some games with it, but I'm still thinking how to use it. And I will get to this, that actually, these networks, if you put them first, and this was my argument, it's very difficult people to engage first. You have to build the community that will need them. And then, too much words. So this is our motto, auch dein Raum in German means that this is also your space. And we are very strict and very encouraging that people should feel it really like a space that it's not curated. We don't judge them. They are just becoming members of a community, of an association, and then they can do whatever they want. There is a wide variety of activity, just to give you some images of the same space, how differently it's used from, this is a feminist group doing this type of circles, podium events, art projects, book presentations, workshops on food, but also geeky stuff like making your own LED sign, engaging with a local radio station and creating some sort of a venue for listening to this station, which is a pirate station from the 80s. So there are all these different activities. And this is my small project. It's just an experiment putting, for example, an etherpad on the window of this space and people being able to use it as a public whiteboard. It is very different when all this happens in public. It creates a very different feeling. So this is all ongoing. We would like to prototype this, both the digital part, but also the governance part. You know, how actually you can go in the Champs-Élysées, I don't know, and bring 200 initiatives renting a space next to, what is with the bags, the Louis Vuitton, and paying a rent of, I don't know, 20,000 by dividing, I don't know, you know, this type of thing that comes together with the whole package, how to coordinate, how to host things and things like that. So a last project that we do in this setting, it's OpenKey. OpenKey is an open source platform for, you can imagine it as a matching platform for self-organized education. One of the most important principles in the platform is that every course, as they call it, has different roles. So it's not supposed to be given by an individual, but somebody has the expertise, somebody is the organizer, somebody moderates, there is decision making. So it's some sort of a collective process for learning things. And so it's a complementary project on which I created a course on the open, on the organic internet. And for example, in one of the events, I called it How to Grow a Small Internet in the Park, just for people to try to feel connected to it and get interested. So this is a self-organized park in the city with similar principles like our space. So they like this idea. We did a workshop with people to design their own, let's say, hybrid, as we call it, interface. So we did a digital guest book for the space that, as every guest book, somebody has to be in the space to sign. So this locality was making sense. And they designed a playful way to invite people to write to the guest book with a screen showing what it's already written, and nothing happened. I mean, this after one some time, this poster started falling. People were telling me, Panos, this does not work. What can we, you know? And then I had to go there to reset it, to curate it. And I was seen as somebody that actually has his own agenda, trying to do something in their space. And it is very interesting how all this changes. The first big moment was when the European project ended. So they got interested after it was not part of a European project. And then some people started liking the idea, asking me, hey, Panos, can you explain how it works? You know, and this is, I mean, I don't want to go to the details, but just to say that this is really a very long process. I mean, from bringing a box into a place that nobody is really a geek until people getting interested to curate it, to use it, to manage it, it's really a lot of patience that it's required. So that's all. Thanks.
Very much, Panos. Any questions? No? That was such a positive
sorry,
talk.
Sorry, I got many things together.
Yeah. Very interesting. I'd like to talk to you, but now I'm just... it was really fast, and I was translating, so I think it's just to say that thank you for sharing. It's really
you want me to say from the beginning? I can
no,
do
no,
it
no,
fast.
No. Yes, I can go through
the message. It's a stupid question, but... have you ever talked to, like, when I talk to people that are in ecological movements, I have always troubles explaining to them why they should develop their own infrastructure. Mm-hmm. Because you cannot really use the argument, there is the economy at scale in that in the case of, so which, how do you convince them? How do you talk to them?
Yeah, actually, yes, it's a very obvious argument that all these digital things should be together, no? The economies of scale.
Yeah, so you cannot really say, look, if you build your own infrastructure, it's actually ecological.
Yeah, very good question, yeah. I have two answers to this. Is that when you create central big things, you spend much more energy than what it's required for the actual communication. I mean, if you calculate all the big data, artificial intelligence, algorithms, I mean, if you calculate the energy cost for having a company like Facebook or Google being sustainable, I mean, myself, I'm positive. So, okay, to run a network over of the whole globe, you know, you have expenses and you have to cover them. To cover them, you need to do a lot of extra effort than it's required just for the communication, even if you are well-intended, just for abuses to control. I mean, it is exponentially, I mean, you save energy per bit because you cool your servers all together, etc., but you have huge costs on running sustainably such big things. This is one answer. The second is that small local things can also use more sustainable energy in easier ways. I mean, you can power them through solar panels, things like that. I mean, when they are smaller, they are more flexible to use different smaller sources of energy and also to recycle things. Because actually, you can use, actually one of our projects in this space is to do this neighborhood web hosting provider using recycled servers. If you go to big infrastructure, you cannot rely in all these old devices. But if you do small things, you don't need this exponential also investment on resources for backups and things like that. And the third answer I give to this is that when you have local networks, you can use them less. I mean, the big networks are meant to, because to become sustainable, they are designed to make us more addictive, more dependent on them, using more and more. And actually, because they connect people that are far, the only way to communicate, when you create local things, you have also the physical interface that does not consume energy. And you have the, let's say, the luxury to design your systems to promote such interactions. I mean, you don't have to create systems that are designed to make everything online more and more. So, you know, it's complicated. It's not just, how can I say, an Excel sheet that you put, assuming that all usage is the same and how it is better, global or local. When you do things a different way, it's a cascading effect on all different aspects that could affect ecology. It's still, I don't convince them. I'm just telling you.
There is a practical example of that. It's the Low Tech magazine. They are hosted on solar power, and it consumes less than 2 watts. So, and it's all optimized, like to be to consume the less power possible.
Yeah. I mean, this is actually I was inspired a lot by Low Tech mechanism, and I have wrote an article, this the organic internet, on the right there, that builds on some of the arguments of the low-tech magazine. And it's also this freedom of saying that, look, the website might be down, no? I mean, this 100% availability, it's, again, it requires an amazing amount of energy to achieve. But if we are trained that if the server is down, we go out, you know, it's okay. I mean, you don't have to have it all the time, no?
I have a small question regarding the way you rent the place in Zurich. Did you use an organization to do it, or was it possible for like a certain amount of people to rent at the same time the
Yes, place? We are an association in Switzerland. It's very easy to create an association. It's called Verein. That it's by default non-profit and democratic in the sense that it has an assembly every year, not every month, you know. So it's not like the dream of an anarchist in a way, but it works. You cannot have profits. And as an association, we rent. The owner is the city, but they rent it as a market price. It's 3,000 euros per month. And actually, we asked them to make the price low. And for political reasons, they said that we cannot look like we are supporting you. And actually, we said this is actually what we are proud of. So in a way, I don't really also personally, I mean, you could hear different stories from the people, but I don't like to be supported because then it becomes more attractive. I mean, how can I say, more easy to replicate. Because if you need always support and subsidies, you will be always some sort of dependent. But if you can say, let's share this with 100 organizations and we pay whatever rent you ask us, then you can just do it. No? And then there are different schemes. I mean, in Zurich, this works well. In Greece, it's a nightmare. These Verein structures, because they require 20 people. There are people that, you know, it's different. I mean, in Germany, in Berlin, there is a very nice project that I like. It's called Mithäuser Syndikat. And they did this type of structure using a company, but creating statutes, how you call them? Yes, and I mean, so they buy houses, but they their company is in such a way governed that actually they can never take a decision to sell a house. And it acts as a cooperative while it's a... So in different countries, you can, you know, the legal schemes could be different.
I have more questions. Last summer, we went to Sarantapolo. And I was wondering what's gonna happen with the MAZI project. Like, what's today and what's the future? You said some people don't want to work, but in Greece, like, is there still something happening? And what's I was on more.
So Sarantapolo is a very interesting story, because actually there are two communities. There is a Sarantapolo, let's say, facilitator group that they live in different cities out of the area, and it's the community that actually lives there. And in the beginning, the Sarantapolo network was just parachuted to the area. Actually, if you ask the people, they will say our biggest mistake is that we promised free internet. And then it was very difficult to take out of the minds of the people that free does not mean that it's free of cost, but they have to contribute. And then through the Net Commons project, we found ways to do a lot of community building, learning, etc. They got also funding from ISOC. And now this is an ongoing process. At this stage, the situation is very good. Actually, you know how the details matter. Everything changed after they made the Telegram group. This was the breakthrough. Really, I mean, it made a big difference, because the people from the cities got immediately close to the community. The people were writing about problems, and there was immediate reaction. And this was the problem before, because they were seen as people from the city coming to the villages one per year to make their project and then leaving. So this intimacy helped a lot. And it works better and better. So people are now more responsible to change their antennas, etc. On the technical level, it's a little problematic in a way that, because all the control of the network happens in Athens, you know, so there are some shortcuts. They use proprietary, this Ubuntu, how no Ubuntu, Ubiquiti with all this, you know. But you have to, you know, it's, I don't know, I mean, it's a long discussion. What it's first, where you can compromise, where not. In terms of community engagement, it goes very well. But it works with technically not what most of you would think as the best solutions.